morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's a great morning today. I'm so glad to see everybody here. We have a very nice service plan today. We're going to be talking about how to spot a counterfeit today. We have a nice service plan, and I hope that you enjoy it. But we're going to start right now with something good called confidence. If we can stand together, we will start. Here we go. We thank you for this time together, and we ask for all of these things, Lord, in your precious name we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. We have one more we're going to do here, a medley, but God is my refuge. It goes like this. Thank you. and make us more like you, Lord. Open our hearts up so we are hungry for you, Lord. Help us to teach us to learn to love you. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer today. Amen. Well, right now we have a scripture reading for you.
The Epistle Jude, verses 3 and 4. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that ye should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness, and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Jude verses 3 and 4.
Praise the Lord. We're going to be talking about that scripture in particular too, but we're going to be in 2 Peter today. But we're going to talk about what it means and how do you spot an apostate. How do you spot a counterfeit, brother, a counterfeit whatever? We're going to talk about that. But right now, we'll have our ushers come forward and pray that you give with a whole heart. We're going to sing one more hymn here called He Lives.
I hear his voice.
you right now, before we switch over for the sermon, goes like this.
Hi everyone, it's Aunt Fernita. Today's story is called Balaam and the Talking Donkey. The memory verse is from John chapter 14, verse 23. It says, "Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching." Today's message is we worship God when we follow his instructions. Have you ever seen a dog do tricks? Some dogs can roll over and sit up. In our story, a man heard a donkey talk, really talk. Let's find out what it said. The Israelites were nearing the promised land, but the surrounding nations had tried to stand in their way, forcing the Israelites to go to war with them. But God was on their side, and each victory sent a message. Balak, the king of Moab, knew he didn't have any hope against that kind of strength. But then he remembered what he had heard about Balaam. Some said that whatever Balaam blessed was truly blessed, and whatever he cursed was cursed. If Balak could get Balaam to curse the Israelites, his army might have a chance. So he sent some messengers to bring Balaam to him. They took along a lot of gold. That was the money of their day. Balaam believed in God. He had once been a prophet, but he had become greedy and no longer served God. Yet when the messengers came, Balaam asked God for instructions. The answer came back, "Do not go with them. You must not put a curse on those people because I have blessed them." So Balaam sent the messengers home, but Balak sent more messengers with even more gold. Balaam knew that God did not want him to go. So he said, "King Balak could give me his palace full of silver and gold, but I cannot disobey the Lord." God knew that Balaam really wanted to go. So that night, God said to Balaam, "These men have come to ask you to go with them. Go, but only do what I tell you." So Balaam saddled his donkey and went with the messengers. Balaam did not see the angel standing in the road to block his way, but his donkey did. So she turned off into a field. Balaam beat the donkey to get her back onto the road. The angel appeared a second time, and the donkey moved against a wall, smashing Balaam's foot. Balaam beat her a second time. The third time the angel appeared, there was no place for the donkey to go, so she lay down in the road. It was after this third beating that the Lord made the donkey speak. "What have I done to you to make you beat me these three times?" she asked Balaam. Balaam was so angry that he answered without thinking. "You've made a fool out of me," he said. "You have ridden me for years," the donkey responded. "Have I ever done this before?" And that's when Balaam saw the angel. "If your donkey hadn't turned away from me, I would have killed you by now," the angel said. Balaam's life had been saved by his donkey. "I have sinned," responded Balaam to the angel. "If I am wrong, I will go back." The angel said, "Go, but you will only be able to say what the Lord wants you to say." When Balaam finally met Balak, he warned Balak, "I can only say what the Lord wants me to say." In three different places that day, Balak asked Balaam to curse the Israelites. But every time Balaam opened his mouth, blessings for the Israelites came out. After the third time, Balak was angry. "Go home," he ordered. "I called you to curse my enemies, but you have blessed them three times. Didn't I tell you I couldn't do anything against the command of the Lord?" Balaam answered, Before I leave, I will tell you what these people will do to your people. Then Balaam prophesied truly. A ruler will rise from Israel. He will defeat the Moabites. The Israelites will destroy the city. God taught Balaam that worship involves everything you do. It is living a life that is pleasing to God. Worshiping is listening to God's voice and following his commands. It is using our voices, our speech, and our actions to honor God.
Here we have a picture of a prophet that kind of strayed away from God. A lot of people talk about we lose our eternal salvation and everything if we stray away from God, but this is not the case. It seemed like he was a prophet of God. He wasn't able to say anything wrong with him, but he kept doing wrong anyway, and we come to find out when Israel went to attack him, he stayed with those kings and he was killed. And sometimes God takes believers, and if they do not act the way they're supposed to, they can just take them home. Lots of times if they're not saved, he just lets them live as long as they want because they're not coming to the Lord anyway. But he won't have bad examples. He'll take you home. But anyway, that's kind of wrapping up that little thing. We're talking about apostate people and preachers that are preaching the wrong things and things like that. And so I want to let you know that we're on this topic of how to spot a counterfeit. So if you have your Bibles ready for chapter 2 of Peter, 2 Peter chapter 2, excuse me. Having discernment is so important, and it's to evaluate people and their situations, but sometimes we need to see the underlying meaning before we can really give the right answer and stuff. Before we determine the answer, we need to figure certain things out. It's like a particular story about a drunk man who smelled like beer, and he sat on the subway next to a priest. The man's tie was stained, and his face was plastered with red lipstick, and a half-empty bottle of gin was sticking out of his torn coat pocket. After a few minutes, the man turned over to the priest, and he asked him, "Hey, Father, what causes arthritis?" And the priest looked at him like that, and he says, "My son, it's caused by loose living, being with cheap, wicked women, too much alcohol, and contempt for your fellow man, sleeping around with prostitutes, and a lack of a bath." Wow. The drunk muttered in response, "I'll be darned, huh?" And he went back and he was reading his paper. Pretty soon the priest felt pretty bad about what he was saying, and he nudged the man and he apologized and says, "I'm really sorry, I didn't mean to come on so strong. How long have you had arthritis?" And he says, "Oh, I don't have it, Father. I was just reading here the Pope does." We should try to understand the question before we give the answer. It's very important. We need to give an answer to everybody about the hope that is in us. Let's go to God in prayer right now. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you very much for this message, and I pray that you would just touch the hearts of people. We seem to be going in a world today where we're always trying to decide who's Christian and who's not. And we know that there's a lot of people that are Seder Christians, and they have a Christian talk, but Lord, they don't really give you both sides of the coin. We don't really see the full understanding which leads people astray. So Lord, I am praying that you would touch the hearts of people and help them to really get some discernment on figuring out who was right and who was wrong, and to stay away from the wrong ones, and to understand things about the world and about the gospel that's being preached. So I pray that you would open their hearts and minds up, Lord, and that they would receive a message. And I pray that you would just bless this message with anointing it and helping them to understand what I'm trying to get them to understand. So thank you again, Lord, for this opportunity to share. And I thank you for your words. And I thank you again, Lord, for all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So would you take God's word and turn to 2 Peter 2? I was reading a magazine again recently about counterfeiting in America. And it begins, the title of it is High-Tech Counterfeiting. The article was talking about the American dollar is still the highest that would be the most imperiled. I mean, everybody wants to copy that dollar. It's still the leading currency in the global marketplace. And U.S. banknotes should now account for approximately over 80% of all counterfeit money is American money, U.S. money. And so it goes on to say, with sophisticated technology so accessible today, can the dollar and its new design really stop the surge of counterfeiting? And the article goes on to say that 10 years ago, you really had to be a printer to turn out a quality product. And he said that we have seen such a dramatic increase in sophistication of counterfeiting, it takes hardly any skill at all today. Well, who knows? Maybe what you have in your pocket right now might not be, you might not be as wealthy as you think you are right now. Maybe what you have is some counterfeit money. But that would be bad. But it really wouldn't be nearly as bad as if you had a counterfeit faith. And I mean not to have the real thing. The basis for the message today is how to spot a counterfeit. Not a counterfeit dollar, but a counterfeit prophet or counterfeit teacher or preacher. I want to start reading right there in 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false prophet teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with vain words make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. So we see here that we're looking at this matter of counterfeit Christians. On your outline today, we're going to be looking at counterfeit teachers, counterfeit preachers, and counterfeit prophets. The world is full of dangerous and damnable heresies, and the need in these last days is authentic biblical Christianity. This is what we need, and the Bible says that there's no greater crime than to be a false prophet. As a matter of fact, a false prophet would be put to death in the Old Testament. Let me show you what it says in Deuteronomy 18, verse 20. It says this, "But the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods," that prophet, it remember even means, I mean, that prophet shall die. That prophet shall die. That meant that he was to be executed. He should be put to death. And it's bad to tell a lie on your outline, but it is worse to teach a lie. It is terribly worse to tell a lie and teach a lie about God, too, because you can cause a soul to be eternally lost. The Bible calls them damnable heresies. But there are three things that I want you to see as we talk about counterfeit prophets, teachers, and preachers. First of all, you need to be aware of their presence. They are here. Let me read verse 1 of that same thing we read. 2 Peter 2, verse 1. And there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. Now, when he talks about people, he's talking about the people of Israel of old. And that is, in the past, there was lots of false prophets, so it's not new. As a matter of fact, false religion is as old as Eden. Remember Cain killed Abel over religion? Remember? There are only two kinds of religions, though. We subdivide religion into Christianity and Buddhism and Islam and Confucianism and Rheumatism and all those other things and everything. And then we take Christianity and we subdivide Christianity and Catholicism and then Protestant religion. And then we subdivide Protestant religion and we say there's Methodist and there's Lutheran and then there's Episcopalian or whatever. Forget all the divisions and subdivisions, because there's only really two kinds of religions in the world on your outline, the true and the false. There's always been false teachings, though, since the Garden of Eden. And they have been, they exist today. And listen to what it says here again in the same verse. But there were false prophets also among you, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. Now, the you refers to the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So he's talking about now to the church that there are false teachers in the church today. As a matter of fact, I'm not exaggerating. I mean, you can think of almost anything that you want to believe, no matter how strange or how bizarre, any way you want to live or anything. And I tell you, you can find a church that you can go to and feel perfectly at home. And it's amazing about what people will believe. Now, I used to think it was strange what people would not believe, but now I've come to think it is more strange of what people do believe sometimes. I have to think it is more strange about that. Paul talks about some of these people who occupy pulpits, and he talked about them in 2 Corinthians 11, 13 through 5. Look what it says here, 11, 13 through 15, excuse me. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, when they're not, whose end shall be according to their works. That means that they're going to die and they're going to go to hell. And they might be called reverend or doctor or something like that, but they do not know the Lord, or they hate the Lord. And they stand in pulpits and as false prophets, as angels of light. And when you look for the devil, never fail to look in the pulpit. Don't let false teachers take you by surprise, because the word of God is here, clearly says they will be among you. And they're called damnable heresies. The word heresies comes from the word divide. And when heresy comes into a church, it always causes people to have to make a choice. If someone brings a false doctrine in into the church, and the pastor and the teacher and the leadership of the church will go, hey, you can't do that. And they say, oh, yes, we can. And we say, no, you can't. You can't believe that. Oh, yes, we can. That's not right. And they say, yes, it is. And there makes a division. And when you deal with these people with their heresies, they will act like they're being persecuted, like they are being put on you. And you're doing something to them, they're saying. But we have the doctrine and we have the church, but when they come in, this is what they do. And they say, well, it's your fault for standing against what's wrong. You know, it reminds me of like the little boys who were fighting in the bedroom. The mother came in to quiet it down, and little Johnny said to the mother, well, Mom, it all started when Jimmy hit me back. That's the way these folks are, these political parties. They do this all the time. I mean, and if the conservatives ever hit back the left, they flip out. You can't negotiate with these people. We shouldn't. I heard of a story, I thought I'd throw it in and stuff. Story about a hunter that went into the woods and he was confronted with a great big grizzly bear. And he thought, well, he would love to have a fur coat. And the bear was thinking, well, he would love to have a meal. Well, as the hunter picked up his big gun and he aimed it at the bear and was going to shoot, the bear said, wait, can't we talk for a little bit? And he said, well, okay. And they went out on the road and talked. And the bear said, I was coming to have a good meal. And the hunter said, well, I was coming to have a fur coat. And they talked for a while, and then they talked. And they talked, and they talked, and they talked. But in the end, the bear got a meal, and the hunter had a fur coat. Don't negotiate with the enemy. Do you know your enemy? When it comes to false teachers, don't compromise, or you will be eaten up. But when people come into the church and stuff, you can't say that with their doctrine and stuff, and you want to say to them that they can't do that, you can't do that. They go, ha ha, you're causing division. But no, they're the ones that are causing division. Sometimes it's hard to discuss these things, and you shouldn't be discussed right in the middle of a church. You should come to the pastor and talk about your doctrine and see if you can go ahead and see if it'll fly in that congregation. But they usually don't do that. They go, no, you're the ones that are causing division. Now, sometimes we have to deal with heresy, whether it's in a denomination or even a local church, but heresy must be dealt with because it can destroy a church. And I have told you before from this pulpit, it's better to be divided by truth than to be united in error. Don't compromise with the word ever. The Bible calls them damnable heresies. We were talking about that in church or in my breakfast about. We have to remember that the Bible is the inherent word of God. It is literally true. I mean, you can't just take parts of it. I was looking on the news today and it just went by and it said that probably only 20 or 30% believe that the Bible is real, and the rest of them think it's all stories and prophecies and just fables. That is a big mistake. You're never going to be born again if you think that. We don't have time. We don't have to get along with everybody, but there comes a time when you have to say that that is wrong. And you have to stand up and say you cannot perpetuate that or perpetrate that. And Martin Luther, here's what he said. The leader of the Protestant Reformation, he said, and I want to quote him here verbatim, I don't want to know anything of peace and concord when the word of God is thereby lost. And the word, eternal life, and everything goes, everything else is forfeited. It is not right for me here to draw back and give way out of love toward you or toward any man. But listen, before the word, everyone must give way. We must bow to the word. It is the truth. And this is where we get our directions and our strength. Jesus is the word that became flesh. And this is why we need to know the word. That's what it said. Sometimes people think, well, the Bible is not true because there's so many false teachers. Sometimes people will say, yeah, Christianity has so many cults and divisions and errors in it. It can't possibly be true. But to the contrary, if there were no false cults, the Bible would not be true, because the Bible says that there will be false cults. Because a counterfeit is something that's important. The devil wants to counterfeit Christianity. This verse says it right here. Look at the first part of 2 Peter 2:1. It says, there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you. And if there were no false teachers, then the Bible wouldn't be true. Because the Bible says that there will be false teachers. As a matter of fact, Paul said it in another place. Look what he said in Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. It says, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the later times, that's now, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. That brings up another question. How do you spot a counterfeit? I mean, the article I saw that talks about spotting counterfeit money, but how do you spot a false counterfeit prophet? That's what we want to think about. What do you look for? Let me give you some ways. We're going to give you 5 tests here right now. And you can take any preacher, any teacher, and base him on this earth and hold him up to these 5 tests, even me. You can tell whether or not he is real or whether he's a counterfeit. Number one, the first on the list is there is the source test. What is the basis of his teaching? Does he have revelation other than the Bible? For example, someone might come to your door and say, oh, we accept the Bible as the Word of God, but we also accept Joseph Smith as the prophet. And they want to lay some other source down alongside of them with the Word of God. I was raised a Christian Scientist, and so we had the King James Bible, though. We always had the Science and Health, which is written by Mary Baker Eddy. So we would understand the Bible. Anybody has to write a book to go along so you understand it. You know, they're taking it out of context. And we ought to remember that even Mary Baker Eddy denounced her religion on her deathbed. But it was so popular and they were making so much money that the guys just kept their religion going, and she just died, and that was it, and it's still going. The Bible says that we're not to add to anything, and we're not to take away from it. And all religions, false religions, add to it or take away from it. We're not to amend it, and we're not to adjust it. So is their source the Word of God, or do they have, on your outline, any other revelation but the Bible? Some people have to have these other revelations. The Bible's not enough for them. But when they say the Bible's not enough for them, they're saying Jesus is not enough for them. Number two, we have to do the Savior test. Do they believe that Jesus Christ, on your outline, is the Messiah, the virgin-born Son of God, co-equal, co-eternal with God the Father? You know, I had Jehovah's Witnesses come to my door a while back. And I stood at the doorstep and I spoke to them courteously and kindly. And they began to speak. And I said, listen, before you go any further, I want to ask you a question. Do you worship Jesus Christ? Well, they said, well, we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And I said, well, the question is, do you worship Jesus Christ? Well, we give him praise and honor and stuff. And I said, that's fine. And the question is, do you worship Jesus Christ? And they said, we reverence him. One more time, I said, do you worship Jesus Christ? And they said, no. And I said, why not? The Bible is full of worship for Jesus Christ over and over again, starting when he was a baby. They're worshiping as the Lord and Savior of mankind. And in the Bible, in the Gospel, it tells how they worshiped him over and over. And he's not God, then of course, he shouldn't be worshiped. But if he is God, he should be worshiped. And then they said, well, excuse us, we have to go. And they left, and because they don't get in arguments. And a lot of times people don't want to get in arguments, especially when the Bible says it right there in front of them. And I wanted to tell them more how they couldn't be born again unless they understood that Jesus is God. And they got all this energy and they're walking around and they're not born again. They don't even know it. But if Jesus isn't God, you can't be born again. Jesus would only die for his own sins. He had died for the sins of the whole world because he is God in the flesh. The Word became flesh and dwelt among man, and man rejected him. He is not God. He shouldn't be worshipped. But the Bible tells and tells us, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God and him only. Now listen, source is the source, which is, of course, the Word of God. But then we have the Savior test, and we see Jesus Christ as the Son of God, as the God of the Son, the Messiah, the God in the human flesh, co-equal, co-eternal with God Almighty, part of the Trinity, or that's what it says. And here is the third test, number 3 on your outline, the subject test. is the primary source of their teaching, the gospel of Jesus Christ. On your outline, the gospel. Paul said, I determined to know nothing among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. I never could figure out what he meant by that, because there's so many other issues in the world, but there's not. Everything has to do with Jesus and him crucified. Everything else comes out of that or falls into all of that, because that's the basis of what we believe in the Bible is all about. And the good news is the gospel of Jesus Christ. On your outline, the Old Testament says somebody is coming. The New Testament says somebody has come. The book of Revelation says somebody is, on your outline, coming again. And that person is the Lord Jesus Christ. That person is him. He is the hero of the Bible. The Bible has one theme, that's salvation. He has one hero, it's Jesus, and it has one villain, and that's the devil. And for spotting false teachers, you need to use your discernment and ask, what is the subject? What is the motivation? Do they want to talk to you about what they call kingdom truths? You need to find out, is it this thing or is it that thing? Is it really the preaching of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, the gospel of salvation by faith, by grace, through faith? That's the thing is about our gospel. Apostle Paul said, if any man preach any other gospel to you, that which I'm preaching to you right now, let him be damned. Let him be accursed. And it means to be damned. And you say, well, that's so harsh. But it's not harsh if it says to somebody, you can't teach something that's going to lead others to go to hell. It's a harsh thing. I can't help that. We're not dealing with something like the preference color on the walls or how much salt we're going to put on the potatoes. We're talking about eternal destiny of people, the source test, the Savior test, Jesus Christ, the subject test, the gospel. Number four on your outline, the salvation test. Do they teach salvation on your outline by grace? Can you receive the gospel by just believing? People have a hard time with that. They think they need to do more than that to get it. And the thing is, when they get it, they do more than that. But they will question it until they finally get it. And do they try to mix works in it? Do they try to mix works in their faith, like with baptism or something? Or do they say you have to have a certain diet or a certain day that you have to worship on? Well, anytime you say to anybody that anything else must be done other than to trust the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved, you know what you've done? You have taken a whole bunch of people and eliminated them out of the gospel. Let's take the battlefield. Suppose a boy got shot or gassed, and the chaplain comes to him and he says, son, are you saved? And he says, no. And the chaplain says, well, son, do you want to be saved? And he says, yes, I do. And he says, well, son, I'm sorry, I can't baptize you. There's nothing but sand out here. And that's why the Catholics sprinkle. Even they have all those buildings, all those cathedrals over there with baptismals. They couldn't figure out that you didn't have to be baptized, because they say you have to be baptized to be saved. The Catholic Church says that Jesus isn't what saves. The Catholic Church says that's what saves. And you have to be baptized. And they just sprinkle so they make sure that they do it. But it's not about the ritual. You get the Holy Spirit as soon as you believe in God. As soon as you find him, put your trust in him, and you know that he's real. You see how foolish that would be if they did that, though. Anytime you put something else in a requirement for salvation, you take the whosoever out. The Bible says, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Do you know what that means in Greek, the whosoever? It says, whosoever shall be saved. It means anybody, anytime, any place, whoever calls upon the name of Jesus in repentance and faith will be saved. Or I'll close my Bible and never preach again. That's the promise I have to cling to. I guaranteed that promise. I had to really guarantee it before I could go ahead and level myself solid in the pit here. So the salvation test, you find out from these people and ask, do you believe the salvation by grace through faith that gives glory to God? That's important for the minister to know. Number five, the fifth test is the sanctification test. On your outline, do they teach? Are they endeavoring to live a holy life? If they're not living a holy life, or if they're not teaching holiness, personal holiness and separation of sin, there's something rotten in the testimony. Folks, you have to hold up those five tests, and I'll tell you that before long, you'll be able to separate the false from the true. Like an agent can learn how to look at a dollar bill, it's a 20 or a 100, and know whether it's a counterfeit or not. First of all, you know how to have to identify them, and you identify them on your outline by their message. That's how you can tell. Here's the second way you identify them, is not only by their message, but by their method. I want to look at that a little bit. If you will look at verse 2, verse 1 speaks of their message. Verse 2 speaks of their method. Now, of course, we're talking about 2 Peter. And then it says that many will follow their pernicious ways. What is their pernicious ways? Well, look at verse 3. What they do for their unholiness is that they use feigned words to make merchandise out of you. Look at what it says in verse 1. It says, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies. All of these are talking about the way they operate. And look at the word privily. It means secretly. It means clandestinely. It means in a way it's hard to spot. You know, you give the devil credit for their being clever because what they do is that they lay false teaching right alongside good teaching, so it's confusing. And that's what they do. And everybody knows that's a good way to confuse other people. And it's a good way to fool people. And they do that with television ads. They do it with contraceptives. They've done it with Planned Parenthood. They do it with sexual preferences, gender decisions, alcohol. They only make it sound good. And remember, like they used to do with the Marlboro Man and the big hat. Well, really, what does that have to do with riding a horse and dying of cancer? But anymore, you can see right there, everybody ought to give up cigarettes because it says if you smoke, you have the danger of getting cancer. But really, I believe that most of the people started in the world because the world said it was good. We did. It was like a weight loss thing. Everybody thought it was good. But that's what they're saying about the vaccines, too. That's what they say about the mask. That's what they say about every war. That's what they say about homosexuality. That's what they say about abortion. Until smoking was like for a weight loss thing, and it sounds like a devil had a pretty good idea there, didn't he? When they have the warning on the packs, too, they make it so small you can hardly read it. As a matter of fact, it prints so small on those billboards I've driven by, you almost get in a wreck looking at them because they're so small. But they put that on there because the law makes them, and they should. But the devil does the same thing. He speaks of feigned words. They always make it sound like the truth and get you off just a little bit, because you only need to be off a little bit to lose salvation or not receive salvation. And it says with feigned words. You know what the word feigned is? It means plastos in Greek. That's where we get our word plastic from. Where we get our word plastic. These plastic preachers and these plastic words. What is plastic? Well, it's something that's pliable and something that molds itself and something that will fit, something that's made to imitate, and they're so good at those feigned words. I was in a post office one time and I met a guy and we were talking there, and this was a while back, and then I was like, he was a professor in a college and stuff, and I had a conversation with him and I thought it was really good. I thought I found a brother and everything. He talks like the things of God, and I just loved, you know, say Jesus, and oh, you got friends, places and stuff. And it was wonderful. We were talking there a little bit. He was talking with somebody else, and finally he was talking to me, and I was talking to this guy. And it was a nice conversation. Then we got to talking about the resurrection and Jesus. And it was a wonderful conversation. But he kind of said something that I kind of smelled a rat or something. I said, let me ask you one question. You believe in the resurrection, don't you? And he says, oh, sure, I believe in the resurrection. Well, here I go with my suspicious nature. And I started to ask a little bit more. I can't seem to shut up. And then I said, well, now, wait a minute. Let me ask you one more question. Do you believe that Jesus Christ walked out of that tomb and the tomb was empty? He goes, oh, no, I don't believe that. I thought, how strange is that? You know, he had some kind of a spiritual resurrection, and I didn't stay around long enough to really find it out, because if you want to find out everybody's wrong doctrine, you'll never come home again. Now, there's just thousands of wrong doctrines out there, because as soon as people get a little bit of information, they use their own understanding to add to it a little bit, and boy, you're really off them. He doesn't believe in the Bible resurrection, and they went in and found an empty tomb. So it's feigned words. We must believe in a bodily Bible resurrection. You know, we had a real body. Touch my body, remember? And what will liberalism, what does it do? What is the problem we have with it? Liberalism, on your outline, will use our words in their dictionary. Sometimes when you talk to these people, you say, that man is a heretic because he doesn't believe right. And they say, well, you're just being a nitpicker. And no doubt he believes in the resurrection. You should just like everybody that likes Jesus. Vernon McGee said one time, he told the story, he's in heaven right now. Of course, he's one of the great Bible teachers. But he had a lady that was going to his liberal church that was down the road from him as a friend of his. And he said to her, why do you go to that church and listen to that man preach? And she said, Dr. McGee, he's a fine man. He's a gentleman. He preaches the same thing that you preach. He uses the same words that you use. Dr. McGee said, does he talk about the resurrection? Does he believe in the resurrection? Well, of course he believes in the resurrection. And he said, well, you go ask him if he believes in an empty tomb, that Jesus Christ came out of that tomb. Well, later she came back to Vernon McGee after asking that question and with tears in her eyes, and she said, Dr. McGee, I can't believe it. He does not believe that Jesus came out of that tomb. We need to have the whole gospel straight or it's not going to work for your salvation. And now we're talking about those fame words, plastic words, and they will make merchandise out of you. And try to hem these folks up sometimes is like trying to hem up a snake in a barrel of oil. I was talking to people about why do you go over to that church and why did they have that fight between this one church and another, and they said, I don't know, I don't really care, I just like the people over there. You know, we're supposed to be here, not only for fellowship, but we're supposed to be here to be learning about God. Amen. That's kind of the main thing here. And if we aren't learning about God, then we're just kind of coming together and we might as well be going to the Moose Lodge. You know what I mean? So you see them with their message as well as their method. Now, thirdly, on your outline, we look at their manner, okay? Look at verse 2. It says, many will follow their pernicious ways. Pernicious. That's a word we don't use very much, unless we say someone has pernicious anemia. And I don't even know what that is either, whatever it is. But literally means is unbridled lust and lasciviousness. You are going to find these counterfeiters because they don't love the Lord and they don't know the Lord. And the sum center and the subset of their message, and you're going to find out, is themselves. I did this, and I think that I know that God talked to me, and I said this, and I think that you need to. And there's a lot of eyes going on in them. There's something. Apostasy and immorality are inextricably interwoven. Let me give you a couple more verses that speak about apostasy and immorality. Ezra read a little bit of Jude today. Let's read Jude 4. For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation. And you knew about it. God said so. Ungodly men turning the grace of God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. They turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. You know, I know people who spout their faith, who live in sin, and they say that Calvary covers it all. But that's heresy. Paul says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. And this is the kind of sins I'm talking about. Look at Jeremiah. It says right here in Jeremiah 23:14, it says, I have seen also in the prophets of Jerusalem a horrible thing. They commit adultery and walk in lies. They strengthen also the hands of evildoers, that none doth return from his wickedness. They are all of them unto me as Sodom, and the inhabitants thereof as Gomorrah. Can you imagine our people in these days? You know, they're encouraging people, Christians saying abortion is good, Christians sponsoring ships to go out and have abortions and stuff like that. I mean, you know, if you're really going to take a stand for it, don't call yourself a Christian. That's just blasphemy, it seems like. But anyway, they call themselves prophets and they're living with sin. But the sins were, they were adulterers and they were liars and they were strengthening evil people. They're Christians that were behind the evil people. And they have their pernicious ways and many will follow them. As a matter of fact, many people would love to have a preacher to drink with them and tell dirty jokes with them and be coarse with them. Why? Because it makes them feel better. It does, and the Bible says that many will follow their pernicious ways because people want to be comfortable in their own lifestyle. Look at verse 2. Therefore, success in the ministry, or what people call success, does not necessarily mean that it's God's work. Because many people will follow these feigned words, and then will follow these false preachers. Statistics is no proof that something's of God, because many will follow their pernicious ways. That's not good. There are many people who would love the sensual rather than the spiritual. And Jesus said, not everybody that says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. He that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many people are living double lives and they are false prophets. And that's the test that I'm talking about. The holiness test and the sanctification test. You can spot a counterfeit by his message. You can spot a counterfeit by his method. You can spot a counterfeit by his manner. Fourthly, you can spot a counterfeit on your outline by his motive. What is his motive? Look at verse 3. It says, through covetousness, that means his greediness, they shall, with feigned words, those plastic words, they'll make merchandise of you. They'll get you to give them to them. What is their motive? They want to make merchandise of you. They want to use you to manipulate you. Why? Because they themselves are covetous. Now, I'm not saying here that a preacher ought to not get paid. I mean, preachers should get paid. He ought to be paid. And muzzle, the Bible says you're not going to muzzle the ox that treads the corn. The Bible says that the preacher of the gospel shall live the life of a gospel. The Bible says the workman is worthy of his hire. The elder that rules well is worthy of double honor. And the Bible tells all about that stuff. And I'm grateful that just any preacher is grateful for the love and the sacrifice of God's peoples that enable us to preach and carry on and put out the gospel. But he's not talking about that. He's talking about people who, for their own motivations and out of their own wicked heart, make merchandise of the gospel. And they're not even getting these words into the people. They're just making them feel good and letting them have fellowship, and they think that they got Christianity. But if you have a television, you've probably seen some of these hucksters and some of these merchandise the gospel of Jesus Christ. So often, they always start off sounding pretty good, but if you weed through it, you find out that there's falseness. If you only listen to it now and then, you might not be too much affected, but if you make it your sole diet, you're going to find a direction that they're gone. In my estimation, the hottest part of hell is reserved for these plastic preachers, for these counterfeit preachers who merchandise God's people. Many times, with great many words, they exploit the ignorant. And they are prophets, all right, but you spell prophet P-R-O-F-I-T. And what Peter does here is he gets real serious and he says, God will surely judge them. God will not spare them. And look at his argument beginning in verse 4. Look what it says here in 2 Peter 2. It's starting in verse 4. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them in the chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, and God spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, he stands for new beginnings, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly. Oh my goodness. And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an ensample, an example unto those that after should live ungodly. And he delivered just law. Just law. That means righteous love. He wasn't that good, but he was righteous because he belonged. Vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. Conversation means behavior. Vexed, feeling terrible with the filthy behavior of the wicked. And then moves on to verse 9, and here's what it says about the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations. That's the rapture. That's us. And to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished, the people that will be left here. He knows how to deliver the saints for glory, and he's reserving the non-believers for destruction. There's a plan made. What's God saying? God's saying, here's God's solemn warning to every counterfeiter. He says, when the angels fell, I judged them. When civilization of Noah's day became polluted, I judged them. When Sodom and Gomorrah became perverted, I judged them. And I'm going to judge these false prophets. So if God spared not the angels, and God spared not the whole world, and he spared not Sodom and Gomorrah, he will not spare these false prophets. And these people that we're talking about, Bill, I know, you know, that are really false prophets, God is going to get them. That's all there is to it. And here's what's on the other side. It says this in Romans 8:32. I forgot to give it to you. No, that's okay. God spared not his only son and stuff. But when Jesus left heaven and came to earth to be my substitute, my sin and your sin was put upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus went to Calvary. They stretched him out on a hellish cross. And that was after they lacerated his back, after they put a crown of thorns upon his head, and after snatching the beard out of his face, and after hitting him with their fists and battered him with their clubs. Then they hung him on the cross, and in torture and pain unimaginable, and Jesus suffered, but he did not cry. No. He suffered as a lamb before the shearers is dumb, and he opened not his mouth. But then something happened, and the heavens became black last at night, like midnight. And there was this horrible, horrible thing that happened. God the Father, who had been with the Lord Jesus from eternity, which was the Word that became flesh, turned his back, and he forsook God the Son. Jesus cried from the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And the answer was, the God has purer eyes than to be able to behold iniquity. Jesus Christ on that cross took my sin and your sin and the sin of billions and all that lived and will ever live. And the sin of the world was laid upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus, who had never sinned, became sin. And Jesus, who had been in the Father's greatest, became the object of the Father's loathing. And God the Father had to look upon God the Son as God the Father would look upon you and me at the final judgment without our sin ever being atoned for. And God the Father had to turn his back upon God the Son. And God the Son cried out, my God, Why hast thou forsaken me? Well, let me tell you something. If there were ever a time that God would have been tempted to go ahead and be lenient on sin, wouldn't it have been when that sin was resting on his darling son who never sinned? He would be more apt to take away his punishment then than any other time. But he had a plan, and he worked it out. God killed the son. And the Bible said that God would not spare him. And it says in Romans 8:32, he spared not his own son for his love for us. Listen to me, if you're intelligent people, if God spared not Jesus when sin was laid upon Jesus, do you think God will spare you when your sin is still on you for not accepting his solution for sin, killing his own son? And he ain't gonna forget. God spared not the angels that stand. God spared not the old world that stand. God spared not Sodom and Gomorrah in judgment. God spared not his own son in redemption, and God will not spare you. But listen to this. There's a blessed truth there, which is he that spared not his own son, shall he not freely with him give us all things? Every time I think of that, I think about something, a tragic thing. I have sons, and if you ever say to me, Daniel, can I have one of your sons? Can I have one? No. Can I have Ezra? No. I want to, why? Why do you want him then? I want to lie about him, and I want to abuse him. I want to beat him. I want to humiliate him. I want to lacerate his back. I want to cut him to shreds, and I want him to hang on the cross that he might die in agony and blood. Will you give me your son? No. I wouldn't give you my son. I wouldn't even think about it. But suppose there was, for some strange reason, there was really a need where you would have to have my son for that purpose, and that my son would have to die maybe for the world or something. Ezra says, I'm not ready. Well, even if you got revived, would you want to go through all that pain and stuff, even though you're going to live through it? No. Suppose you talked to me about loving you and believing in me so much that I was going to give you my son, Ezra, and you said to me, wow, cool. Can I have his football, too? Well, sure, you can have his football. What about his jeans? Yes. What about his books? Yes. If I loved you enough to give you my son, certainly I'd give you anything. I said, that's what God is saying. He gave his only son to be tortured on the cross so we would have life in him. And we don't really care. So often people don't. Only born again people do. But if you're not born again, you don't really think about it that much. And here's what Paul says in Romans 8, and I want you to hear it. He that spared not his own son but delivered him up for us all, how should he not also with him freely give us all things? If God loved us enough to give us Jesus, what would he withhold? What's he saying? He's saying, listen, don't get caught up in counterfeit Christianity. God is unsparing God, and he will not spare sin, and he will not spare the sinner. He did not spare his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to prove it. But so you and I might be saved. You and I might have eternal life. Because the world is full of counterfeits, you have to make sure you have the real thing. One last word, and are you listening? There are some of you who have counterfeit dollars out there, and I'm going to give you some good advice. Just get rid of all your money, and you won't have any counterfeit anymore. That's like when you have a bad doctor, just give up all doctors. No, but you're right, we can't do that. There are some counterfeit Christians out there, though, but you don't want to let that keep you away from the Lord Jesus Christ. Because there's a lot of funny stories about what's going on with the Bible out there. And we know we're pretty solid right here. And I'm not saying that, you know, we don't really get involved in a lot of the things at a lot of the churches, but one of the things that we're very interested in is having the knowledge so we have strength when we come into battles. I'm going to be reasonable. The counterfeit really on your own only proves the worthwhileness of the validity of the real. That means people don't counterfeit gum wrappers. They only counterfeit something that's valuable. And you don't have any counterfeit Muslims. You don't have any counterfeit of these others, Buddhists. You don't have any counterfeit of those other things, but you have millions of counterfeit Christians. And every counterfeit piece of currency is a tribute to the worthwhileness of the real. And every counterfeit Christian is a tribute to what we have and the value of it. So don't let counterfeits keep you out of heaven. And I want to tell you this, that Jesus is real and salvation is real. And it can be real if you will repent of your sin and trust him. And how many today would be able to say, Pastor Dan, I listen to those tests, those five tests. I apply them to my heart and my life. And I see that I am real, or if I'm a counterfeit, and I did it, and I feel like I am truly saved. I'm truly saved by the grace of God. And therefore, if I died tonight, by God's grace, I would go straight into heaven. Well, that's good. But if you can't say that, even beyond the shadow of doubt or peradventure that you're saved, brother, and you would like to know that you're saved, you want to get it settled today, we can do that. Because you see, if you say, Pastor, I don't have this certainty, and I wish I did. If a person can know that they're saved, I want to know. I want to be right with God. I really do. I want that salvation that we talked about. I really do. I want to have the real thing. I don't want a counterfeit. I want that which is real. Before we pray, I want you to know beyond the shadow of a doubt that I am saved. If you want to know that, then you can be certain right now, because right now you can enter into an abundant eternal life with your sins forgiven as you grow in this faith, and that time you will know then how you can spot a counterfeit. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray today that they would understand salvation by grace, Lord, and that they, in the name of Jesus, would receive the salvation so they can have a certainty. And they would know for sure, Lord, that their trust in Christ and that their ending is certain, Lord. Lord, we step into abundant life, and it just leads right into eternal life. It's not that when we die, we go eternal. We find abundance when we come to you now. And so, Lord, I pray, Lord, that people would understand that you love them so much, that that's why you came and died and rose again, sent your Holy Spirit back, made a plan for salvation. We fill us up with that Holy Spirit, Lord, so we can have a life together with all other Christians in you, Lord. What a wonderful blessing it is. And what a sad thing it is for those who miss this. But Lord, I pray that you would just go ahead and take each person here and have them ask themselves in their heart to come in, for you to come into their lives and change them and make them with the joy that comes from knowing you, Lord. Help them to grow. Help them become more like you. So once again, Lord, we thank you. We love you, Lord, and we turn our lives over to you again, and we thank you, and we ask for these things, Lord. In your precious name we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. And that's the sermon today. We have one last song. If we can stand together, we'll go ahead and sing. It's appropriate. I love you, Lord. And it goes like this. And we love him. Here we go. Here we go, sing of the horn.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship. Let it be a sweet
thank you for your word and your message. And I pray, Lord, that you would just touch the people's heart and fill them up with something that would just help to put a boldness in their life and give them the wisdom, Lord. Help them to teach to pray for wisdom. Teach them to pray for holiness, Lord, and teach them to share with others. So, Lord, I am so thankful for what you're doing and how you're working in our lives and in this church. We just turn it over to you again. I pray that you just bless them really good, Lord. And we thank you again. Send them out and send them back. And once again, Lord, we thank you and we love you. We ask for all of these things, Lord, in your precious name we pray, in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. 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 Have a great day. Remember, next week we're on the resurrection body.